So anyway, my name is Ty. I'm the assistant director of the Copyright Licensing Office, which is in the library. We've been around for probably like 10, 15 years, I think. This is Shalise with me. She's a law student who does some research for us, and I thought she might benefit from the presentation as well. She's pretty new and has an interest in copyright law, so we snatch up all the law students who are interested in copyright law. My background is I was a music major here and got my master's in music here at BYU, so I'm a musician and headed to law school. So I got into copyright through an internship in LA with Fox, 20th Century Fox. I did some of their music licensing, and then I worked for BYU Broadcasting and did all of their music clearances as a student, which shows how much resources they had doing that. And then I worked there full time, or sort of after I graduated, and then started my own company that was a music and rights clearance company for film and television. So for various corporations and documentary makers and TV shows, they would want to use clips of media or images or music, and they didn't know how to get clearances or didn't really want to, and I had contacts established with the industry, so they would hire me to go out and negotiate those clearances and then obtain them for their products. And then I started this job when I was coming back and working on my master's. So that's kind of I came into copyright a little bit. I'm not a lawyer yet, so that's what's unique about me in this job, but just came about it from the trenches, kind of working it on the ground. Let's see if this will work.
There it is.
You got it? Sweet. Great. So two of you have taken the tutorial. Great. What did you guys think?
I was definitely schooled in my knowledge of copyright, to say that. So
now you need to train the rest of the people here, because you're experts.
All right, Weston.
So basically, some of the questions I'll answer right up front. Aaron sent me a few questions. Can you download YouTube videos legally? The answer is no. That's a simple answer. And without the permission of the copyright owner, which is the YouTube uploader, which, as you might well understand, they may not own what they've uploaded, which makes digital copyright very complicated. But there are some instances, and I don't want this to be like a slippery slope, but there are some instances where fair use could justify downloading of a YouTube video. And I'll give you one example. A music professor wanted to use a rare footage of a jazz club, I think of Billie Holiday singing in a jazz club, and it was some guy who uploaded the video. He found it, a copy of the tape in his basement, and uploaded it, and you cannot find the footage anywhere else. It's not for sale, it's not being commercialized. And within the use of the classroom, I felt like that was probably a pretty good fair use analysis, that he could download that video to use it for pedagogical purposes. But you know, the question of whether or not that could be used in a documentary, that's a whole different legal analysis, and may be justified. Because fair use, the impact on the market is a big question. But that's, so the simple answer is no to YouTube downloading videos.
So some of us know more about copyright than others.
Okay.
It's enough to be dangerous at some point, but I understood for the most part that if you're doing it inside a classroom, you can pretty much do anything. Am I wrong on that?
No, you're basically right. The problem with the modern classroom is the digital extension. A lot of people want to then take the materials they use in a class and upload it to a server or upload it, and that's where it gets fuzzy. But in a classroom, there's a lot of leeway. In fact, there is a classroom exemption. It's called Section 110.1, and it allows for the performance or display of any copyrighted work for any reason within a classroom without permission.
So in this YouTube example, could they download it, give it to the faculty to use in a classroom?
Well, see, when you say download, you've now created a copy. The law says you have the right to perform or display, not reproduce. So that exemption wouldn't cover you, but depending on the nature of the video, like why would you be downloading it on YouTube as opposed to obtaining it somewhere else?
I have a question. Like, this goes along with it. For example, if there's like a free stock footage, it says like free stock footage, but it's on YouTube, but someone has put it up under the context like this is free and for public use. Does that make it okay to use it or no?
So a videographer uploads footage that he created?
Yeah. Like
footage that he created?
Yeah. Or like a company. Because there are like companies out there like iStock, for example.
Yeah.
That create stock footage and video.
Uh-huh.
And some of their content is free for all public use. Right? But for example, if you were to locate this said video on YouTube and download it, is that legal if it says it's free on there?
Oh, probably. Because
okay.
the owner is giving you license to use it.
Okay.
The reason I say downloading a YouTube video is not legal is because A, you can't do it through YouTube's site. That's
definitely
a first flag. Is that you have to use a third party site to download it, right? YouTube doesn't offer a download option.
Yeah.
So technically, you are still violating YouTube's terms of use. That risk is probably pretty low, but YouTube's terms of use, when you agree to use their service, you say you're not going to download.
Yeah.
Also, millions of people say they're not going to upload infringing content when they use YouTube, which, as we know, doesn't happen. So,
but YouTube lets you embed video in websites.
That's different.
So that's cool.
Well, see, we need to get to the basics, because
okay,
I need to be able to refer
sorry,
to the
I'm
basics.
Like taking you
but the embedding, you're not creating a copy.
Okay.
So think of the word copyright.
Yeah.
As it originally was envisioned, is to create copies. That is the problem.
Okay.
Okay? There's exclusive rights of copyright owners to have control over the copies that you create. Back in the day, it was monks copying Bibles. That's how you could create a copy. Then the printing press happened and all...
Yeah.
You know, everything went from there. And that, and now you can make a copy as quickly and as easily as you want. And that's where the law hasn't technically really caught up probably to a lot of what we're dealing with. So we have to deal with, you know, this law that the 1976 Copyright Act, which is what we're still under, was written in the 60s and passed in the 70s. So it's a very, very old law. And it actually surprisingly,
before these guys were even alive.
Oh yeah, yeah. So it has been surprisingly malleable, and there have been additions made and all that. But it did not envision what we're currently dealing with. And you know how technology has increased exponentially. So the copyright law, I mean, as much as people want to say it will never catch up to technology. So we should never think that, oh man, I wish we had a copyright law that was up to speed. It will never, ever happen. So they have to write law that will help us to just kind of make decisions. Okay, so I'll just quickly go through some of this for you. Basically, I kind of mentioned this, but we get copyright law from the UK. That's all you need to know from this slide. It's kind of, copyright law didn't really exist until the 1700s at all. So, and this was partially because of the control of copies didn't matter until the press was invented. And copyright law actually comes from the Constitution. Article 1, Section 8 says the Congress shall have power to promote the progress of science and useful arts. This will be an important thing that I'll refer to later, because a lot of people, when they hate on copyright, this is what we can talk about, is that the purpose of copyright is to promote progress, to promote creation, additional creation. So, and then it also deals with patents, which is right, discoveries. And back in the day, they only passed copyright for writings, and we have now gone from writings to photography, to architectural drawings, to music, you know, which is now considered a writings. But that's, Article 1, Section 8 just says that they can give exclusive rights to authors of writings. And then we've had various copyright acts. Now we're under the 1976 Act. And then it'll probably change. This gives you an idea of what the technology was in 1976. this was your DVR, so. And there was your computer. I often get questions about copyright versus trademark, and some of this was in Aaron's questions as well. Trademark is a word or symbol that's used with goods and the commerce and trading of goods. So, like you can't. Interestingly, the Stretch Y, we tried to get it copyrighted as a work of art, and we were denied registration from the Copyright Office. But and actually, I don't even think it's registered yet. But some of the marks at BYU are registered as trademarks, and they're just basically symbols to indicate commerce and goods and to avoid confusion. So like Delta Faucets is different from Delta Airlines. They can have the same name. They don't have the same mark, but those are different trademarks. There's a recent Supreme Court case about trademarks with the Slants. Did any of you guys see this in the news? The Slants is a Asian band who intentionally used the word slants, which is formally a derogative term for them, and they wanted to embrace it, but the Trademark Office said we can't register that mark because it's potentially derogatory, but they're Asian themselves, and so anyway, went all the way up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court ruled that they could use that term. And Redskins it's been a problem for the NFL, and so some of those issues, the Utes hasn't been a problem legally yet, but those kinds of things, those are trademark issues. So in intellectual property, there are generally three categories. You have patents, which are inventions, trademark, which are which I just described, and then copyright. There's also trade secrets, but we don't really worry about those.
Secrets, so we won't talk about them.
Exactly. Too secret to talk about. So some examples of copyright versus trademark, just so you know, it's a great album.
I have a question. So you guys don't handle any I'm the sole designer in the room. You don't handle any like logos, any of that stuff. Like,
so we handle questions about fair use of trademark, but there is a BYU trademark office that handles the BYU trademark.
Yeah. So there's a website where it's like if you have a net ID and you can like download their trademark logos. But I was just wondering, like, I mean, I'm probably never going to use another logo outside of BYU for anything that I do here, but...
The use of the logo, the BYU logo, the management of that is through Adam Parker in the trademark office.
Okay, cool.
He's the guy who goes around and makes sure nobody's selling t-shirts with BYU trademark without licensing, so... this Education Week network is coming up every 5 seconds. Okay. It's amazing we can get anything done with all of these people on campus. And patents are just for inventions. So that's just so you can understand the differences of these types of intellectual property. It's a great chair. Other works that are not subject to copyright, words and short phrases, ideas cannot be copyrighted, blank forms, calendars, height, weight charts. Typefaces actually cannot be copyrighted, but the software to create the font can, if that doesn't confuse you. Basically, if you can reverse engineer this typeface, you wouldn't be breaking copyright law, but if you copy the code that created the typeface, you would be breaking copyright law. So,
anyway. There's a backdoor in getting every font ever.
And facts can obviously not be copyrighted, so that's maybe less relevant to a media team, but dissertations and things like that are questions about that. And I had a Seinfeld clip, but we should probably just move on. The clip is, any Seinfeld fans?
Yeah.
It's Elaine with the muffin shop, and she has the muffin top idea, and her boss steals the idea, and you know, those ideas can't be copyrighted. No, top of the muffin to you. It's a great clip. Anyway, so what is copyright then? Copyright is just a form of protection for original works of authorship. That's how the code describes it. So when we determine what constitutes original work of authorship, that can be debatable. But clearly media, images, music, all that is considered original work of authorship. And how are things actually copyrighted? So I get a lot of questions like, is this copyrighted? Can I use it? Just assume everything is copyrighted, basically. We are now under an automatic copyright protection. You don't have to register your copyright, which is ridiculous, but that's just the way it is now. So, but you can't sue if you don't have a registration. So there is that, but you, yeah.
So what's the point of?
In order to join the international treaties, we had to agree that we would not require registration.
Okay.
So that's why we don't have it. We used to have it back in the 50s, which I think we should go back to, because it's like, if you care about your copyright, you will register it. And now, because everybody has a copyright in every single photo they've taken on their phone, I have these ridiculous assessments to make about whether or not this person is going to sue us, you know. Anyway, so that's a personal aside. I should clarify for the video. That is not official policy. Did you have a question?
Oh, no, it was just scratch my head.
Yeah. So, anyway, and it has to be fixed in a tangible medium. That's what the law describes as in order to be. So choreography is a good example. How do you protect choreography? Well, they have to video it, or they have to notate it. You have to fix it in a tangible medium in order for something to be protected. So that makes sense. All right. So do you need to register it? Essentially, yes. So a lot of this stuff, we'll kind of talk about BYU copyrights as well, like what you maybe own or what you create outside of work as well. But if you care about copyright, you should definitely get it registered, especially since timely registration helps you in receiving damages. The consequences, oh, did you see that? I was going to ask you, how much do you guys think Congress has awarded, or Congress has allowed for damages, statutory damages, which is means it's defined by statute instead of actual damages. What do you think the maximum statutory damages that are allowed for each copyright infringement? Did you see it?
$100,000.
Close. You must have saw something.
I think I saw it. I think it said 170.
$150,000. So if you think about one of my favorite cases to talk about with this is the VidAngel case. VidAngel is on the hook right now for $150,000 per stream. Jeez. And per ripping of a DVD. So that's a lot of money. But Congress wanted to make sure that people wouldn't infringe copyright. So they made damages really, really expensive. Now, it can be as low as hundreds of dollars if it's non-willful and if the judge thinks there's a reason that it shouldn't be that much. But companies aren't given that much leeway. So, and then you can actually get attorney's fees as well, which can be millions of dollars. So,
just a question.
Yeah.
So usually, like, when you watch a movie, like, the first thing says, like, if you copy, like,
yeah,
the
FBI
warrant, but it's like $500,000.
So they're probably, I think they're talking about the criminal code rather than the copyright code. So there are a couple of different codes that might apply to what you're doing. Like, for instance, I mean, this is the Title 18 code that you can also be in prison for up to 5 years. But yeah, so it's probably referring to it.
What? For copying a movie, you could go to jail for 5 years.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
But there is a guy who set up a peer-to-peer file-sharing network in his basement. He did go to jail for that, of sharing media and movies, or movie and music.
Napster?
No, he got off scot-free. And he's friends with Mark Zuckerberg, so that's not a good example of
the right way to do things.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, it's debatable what he did.
But the right way is.
I know, because that's honestly some of the argument from, I think, VidAngel and the entrepreneurship is like, we're pushing the boundaries, you know, and we're gonna create new or better law. And Napster basically caused iTunes to come on the market, you know, and so now. Anyway, that I won't get into, but just know that you're really putting yourself at risk if you do that. So most of us are not really in this category of willful. I mean, I don't know many people who are setting up a server in their basement and doing a peer-to-peer file sharing nowadays, and, you know, just belligerently. I mean, there are a lot of Game of Thrones fans who are doing that, so, and it's like the most pirated, you know, media out there, and it's kind of like, it's kind of been a stamp of pride for some of the, I think, the creators. It's funny, because in Hollywood, you'll get people who hate copyright infringement, people who are like, yeah, you know, it's fine, and then the studios always hate it because it's their bottom line, of course. But so they get all sorts of opinions. You should never consider one as a representative opinion of any industry. Okay, so who can be a copyright owner? This is the question.
Everybody.
Yeah. Most people don't realize they're copyright owners by what they create, what they write, their essays, their pictures, the media, a lot of stuff that they do. So everybody can, except him. So have any of you
seen? Actually, they tried to do that, right?
Yeah.
This is literally a lawsuit. People for the ethical treatment of animals are suing on behalf of Naruto to try and get copyright protection in this video. Because he actually took this selfie, Naruto did, this monkey did. Which is a really well framed selfie, you know?
It's beautiful.
So, the focus and the. Anyway, the professional photographer left his camera unattended in the jungle. And they came and were playing with the trigger and took a lot of pictures. And this one came out. And then Wikimedia picked it up, or Wikipedia, and started spreading it. And then the guy sued. But then he didn't take the picture. And under copyright law, whoever takes the picture owns copyright, which is ridiculous. If you go to Disneyland and somebody else takes your picture for you, they technically own the copyright. But
you don't prove it, though, right? How would they prove that they took that picture? It's
at Disneyland or
yeah.
The monkey? It'd be hard to prove. Yeah, that's
well,
why
they have cameras all over Disney.
You can maybe track it down, but no. Yeah, I mean, for all intents and purposes, it's you don't worry about that. But this Naruto took this picture, and PETA thinks that he deserves copyright protection. But the U.S. Copyright Office has thankfully stated that works that lack human authorship are not they don't get exclusive rights. Which actually is an interesting argument to have with artificial intelligence coming up. Like, how much, where does the IP lie, as we get smarter and smarter bots? But that'll be fun to talk about later. Anyway, so 17 USC is the code if you're interested in ever looking it up. But basically, these are the categories of copyright. So we started with just writings, remember, under the Constitution. And now we've extended to musical works, dramatic works, pantomimes and choreographic works, pictorial, motion pictures, sound recordings, and most recently architectural works. Yeah.
And sorry, what is this again? This is in the Constitution.
Article 1, Section 8 is the copyright clause, and then the actual code is 17 USC, which means the U.S. code.
Section 8 and, sorry.
17 USC.
USC.
So if you just type Google that, you can get the whole code online. So whenever I say like 1101 or 107, any of those types of things, that's within 17 USC, which is kind of nerdy legal talk, so I don't know. Apparently one person is interested, but if you are, you can go to the source, which I always approve going to the original primary source. So anyway, these are what can be copyrighted. And this is probably one of the biggest takeaways I think you as a group should probably understand. Because you can't know if you're going to infringe if you don't know what rights you would technically be infringing. So we came up with an acronym, which is helpful, RAP triple D. There are 6 exclusive rights of copyright owners. And if you remember this, then most of your questions, like can I download a YouTube video, can be answered by looking back at these exclusive rights. So RAP triple D, can actually anybody guess what the R would stand for? So these are rights that copyright owners have for their works.
Reproduce.
Yep. And then the next one, it's a little bit harder, but it has to do with a derivative work, which is adaptation. Which the code says to prepare derivative works. So this is just for our acronym.
Wait, I have a question on that then.
Yeah.
Like remixes of like music, that's technically an adaptation of original work. How do people get away with that?
Well, not everyone does. So Madonna was sued for using, this is ridiculous, I think they lost, but using like a 0.5 second horn hit in her, I don't even know how they caught it, in her, one of her tracks.
Because like, for example, there's like, the Vanilla Ice versus like,
David Bowie and Queen, that was a problem.
Yeah, and so Vanilla Ice lost a whole bunch of money. That is like, you know, one thing. But then if like some DJ takes a song and then like adds a bunch of stuff onto it, that's technically still an adaptation, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
So if the artist wanted to sue them, they could.
Exactly.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's kind of surprising how there's so many remixes out there then, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of artists who are okay with it, you know?
Yeah.
I think like Cascade is one of the biggest.
Besides, if they did decide to sue somebody for that, like everybody would hate them.
Yeah. There's also the PR. The PR thing is a very real thing.
Like, I'm suing you over a remix. Like, what?
Like, Taylor Swift would totally do that, though.
Although she's back on Spotify now.
Yeah.
So, you know, Orson Scott Card, for instance, when they made Ender's Game, they had to get his permission to make a screenplay adaptation of his book. And same with J.K. Rowling. So.
I have the next one.
Yeah.
Does this include, like, spin-offs? Like, you know, there's these sitcoms like Cheers that have played for a long time, and then, you know, there's a spin-off which is Frasier, and that is that.
That's a good question. So the definition of a derivative work is a work based upon one or more pre-existing works.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
So that's the legal definition. I assume they probably. Figured it out.
I assumed that sitcom probably was the same people were working on it, but I don't know. I just that question just came to mind.
Yeah, most likely. If you're, I think, what was it?
Or like fan films.
Dang it! What was that one?
Oh yeah, the Star Trek ones in the suit.
Yeah,
Star Wars universes.
Yeah, so like Star Trek fan films. Recently caught into legal trouble because they did a Kickstarter for like $1 million to make a fan film, and CBS obviously did not like that. But then the director of the most recent Star Trek film tweeted that he was cool with it, and then that caused this huge.
Well, they also had like some of the original actors on it.
Oh,
yeah. The guy who played Chekhov from the original series, he was in it.
So once you start getting like too legit,
like start asking questions.
Most of the time,
apparently it is time to quit.
I think it was Calvin and Hobbes. I think somebody tried to do an older Calvin and Hobbes story. So just Calvin. He probably still doesn't have Hobbes. But he particularly, Mark, or what's his name? Watterson?
Bill Watterson.
He doesn't license anything. But he also doesn't really go after anybody, as you can see by the Calvin
stickers.
Peeing on the Ford
right.
symbol.
Yeah.
But or he doesn't, he w- yeah, or whatever, yeah. He doesn't, he's infamous for not licensing anything at all. Like no merchandise, no greeting cards, nothing. But anybody who's doing it illegally, technically. But good, the next one, you know?
So, just a question. So like all this like comic strips that we see around campus, they're all like copyrighted.
Which one? The punksters?
Oh, the comic strips we see like on the offices or around campus, they are all like.
Oh, did they just rip to cut
them
out?
Yeah, they like print and like.
No, if you just cut it out of the newspaper, you haven't.
No. Like they print from the internet, print on a page.
Oh, yeah.
So
I don't know, because like Dilbert, he offers his comics for free online, so it just depends.
Okay.
But yeah, at default, yes, they have exclusive rights in copying. This is a really weird concept for people who grew up with the internet, because there's just copies of everything everywhere. And really, now because of the internet, because of that, it's really more your application of it. So you basically assess your risk, and putting it on your door, I mean, the risk is almost none. It's not that I'm condoning copyright infringement, which I actually kind of am, but it's because we all infringe all the time, yeah.
Did you hear about the Ethan Hila case?
No.
With YouTube?
Oh. Yeah.
Ethan Hila?
Yeah, it'd be Klein versus Haas. They,
I have heard about that.
Matt Haas.
Uh-huh.
And so, like, they were making fun of his video, and they used, like,
that's ridiculous.
Lots of pieces of his video, and so he sued them, cost them, like, hundreds of thousands of dollars and a year and a half of their lives, but they just won the suit last night.
Oh, I didn't follow that closely.
Yeah,
that's good.
So basically,
they were claiming fair use.
Yeah, they were claiming fair use, and so
good.
They wanted every everything they want.
So. Absolutely, as well as they should. That was ridiculous. All these YouTube, you can't use copyright to censor, and people tried to do that.
Yeah.
And that's a form of censorship. Copyright, especially in America, Go America, is it's First Amendment. You know, you should be able to have free speech, and that's why when we get to fair use, that's exactly. So, like, I think another YouTuber was they had a takedown notice for a movie review that wasn't good.
Yeah, negative movie review.
That's ridiculous,
yeah.
Right? So, so fair use is an exemption to these rights.
Okay.
So fair use basically gives you a pass on infringing these six rights. It says if you do it for purposes of comment, criticism, research, scholarship, then you don't need to get permission for implicating these rights. So it's just, that's what it is, a pass. Are you scratching your ear?
Well, I have a question, but I was just... so like if you make a remix and then at the end you're like, that was a great song. You could like pass it off as a comment. Like at the end, you're like, my name is Andrew Congleton, and that was a great song.
I'll let you try that.
No, you should read the judge's opinion on that case because that would answer your question.
Yeah.
Usually, the work itself needs to be commenting on it. So if your remix is making fun of something, then you might be poor. But that's when we get to fair use, we'll talk about parody versus satire. A lot of stuff that happens on BYU campus is satirical. It's not a parody. It's using somebody else's music to make fun of Provo or to make fun of BYU or whatever. That's satirizing rather than actual parodying. Parodying is when you're making fun of Madonna or you're making fun of Taylor Swift and their song, or in a movie you're criticizing or commenting on the movie itself, not using somebody else's work to get views on your YouTube channel.
Is that the next one is parody?
No. No, because that's not an exclusive right. That's a fair use. So public performance is the next one, which the law defines as like movies on campus, for instance. That's a public performance rather than a display.
So
right now, all the music that's performed on campus, we have blanket licenses with organizations that cover the playing of music in the stadium and the Marriott Center and wherever. So we pay for those licenses. Yeah.
Like, if a musician covers a song in concert that isn't their song, they're breaking copyright.
So most venues have these same licenses.
Oh, okay. Because, like, for example, I just saw a band that's one of my favorites, Portugal the Man, and they cover tons of other bands during their set.
Yeah.
Every time. So
the venues, artists don't generally need to worry about it.
Okay.
So the venues are the only ones who have been sued. But there have been, there was a venue in Georgia that was sued. There was a bar or restaurant, and they had open mic, where they had kind of musicians come in, and they would play covers. And they contacted and said, you need a license from us. And they said, no, we don't. And they were sued, and then they were on the hook for like $5,000 a song, I think, which they could have gotten up to $150,000, right?
Yeah.
But so that does happen from a venue standpoint. It's their responsibility. So us as BYU as a venue, when we had, you know, Chicago back in the 70s or whatever, we had public performance licenses for that music.
Cool.
And for movies, we get them individually for every movie. Yeah.
So did I hear you right that BYU has a like a blanket license? How does that work? Is it just like you pay the U.S. government X amount of money?
No, it's a good question. So there are three what we call performing rights organizations. And they, because it's so impossible to track down who's playing your song where in the country, these organizations have been in existence since the 40s, I think. You know, started by Cole Porter and some of these early songwriters. They said, let's get together and create a society. So there's ASCAP, A-S-C-A-P. Is the largest performing rights organization, and then there are two others, BMI and CESAC, S-E-S-A-C. And those, most countries just have one, but those societies manage the public performance of music, so they give us what's called a blanket license, and we pay them a fee, and then we don't have to worry. They have millions of works, so virtually all known music is in their catalogs, and that's what covers us for the performance of that music.
Cool.
Yeah.
And so you need to contact all three or just one?
All three.
How much does that cost?
This depends on I can't tell you how much we pay, but it depends on the organization. So like a dance studio who has to get it, I think it's like $200-$300 per organization a year.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
So it's like $1,000 a year, I think. It's usually pretty reasonable for whatever your purposes are.
Cool.
But, yeah.
So if I have a legal copy of a song,
mm-hmm.
and I play it in an auditorium with people,
mm-hmm.
am I okay?
Depends on the auditorium. You play here on campus?
No. Like a school, maybe high school or something like that.
K through 12, you don't need to worry. So it depends on where.
Okay. It depends on where. Even if I have a legal copy, I have to be careful where I play it.
Yeah, but why? That's a good question, because the exclusive right of a copy you have obtained legally, so you're not reproducing, but you are infringing on the potentially the public performance. So that's why there's a separate right. Just like when you own a movie, you can't play it to 1,000 people. You know, Provo City, just because they own a copy of that movie doesn't mean that they can do the movie nights on a hill for free. Does
really?
That make sense?
Even if they're not making money on it?
Uh-huh.
Even if it's just like free, hey, I'm going to play my DVD on a screen for like 200 of my best friends.
So the law defines a public performance as a performance at a place open to the public,
okay.
or to outside the close circle of family and friends. So you could probably, if you really do have 200 friends.
Like, hey, all of Provo is like my best friend. Like,
you'll be a great lawyer. No, if you're doing it at a place that's open to the public, then yes, it technically would. If you're doing
wow.
it at your house. Now, listen, this is all the black and white code, okay?
Yeah.
Then we're going to talk about risk assessments and all of that.
Okay.
But yes, you singing a song in public is technically a violation if there's no public performance license, but nobody cares about that.
Can
so.
Do it. Break the law.
Is there a couple other... Did you have any?
Yeah, so technically it is illegal to watch a movie outside. I've always heard that. Unless it's like in my yard.
Well,
that's my
what's the definition I just told you?
In a public place
outside
your personal circle of friends and family.
So you could probably answer your own question. In your yard?
That's my own.
But
if it's not in my yard, then it's...
Technically. But like, if you go watch at a park... I mean, I know when I was a freshman, they told us... we tried to watch movies outside in the yard.
Mm-hmm.
That's a strict conservative BYU policy. It's not really a black... That's our interpretation because... Hollywood came to BYU and said, hey, you guys are stealing our music. I actually was here in 2004, was my freshman year, which was like the height of LimeWire and Napster and all this sort of stuff. And
yeah.
we were peer-to-peer file sharing like crazy. Thousands of songs in the dorms, right? Dorms were these hotbeds of like sharing. And I didn't know. I thought it was fine. So they contacted universities and said, you need to start cracking down. And BYU swung very right, obviously. And they just don't want to worry about it. So whether or not that's legal or illegal, I actually think it's probably fine, but or at least low risk. But that's why that policy exists on campus.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's more like a personal query as to, okay, you pay the rights to this, for example, for songs, you pay these companies to get a license. And like, how is the, like, for example, if, I don't know, I decided to make a concert with all the songs of Journey.
A what, sorry?
I decided to make a concert with all the songs of Journey,
uh-huh.
for example. And then I go and I pay this three organizations in order to get a license so I can...
Well, you just pay the organization that has the Journey songs, which
yes.
may just
so
be one.
How is this being passed to the...
Oh, the songwriters?
Yeah, because
isn't that
the problem?
That's a great question. And it's, you know, ASCAP, EMI, and CSAC are under a lot of fire for their transparency. ASCAP and BMI are nonprofits.
Mm-hmm.
CSAC is a for-profit, but CSAC is an invite-only organization. So like Bob Dylan on there, I think Adele just got on CSAC because they claim that they get them higher royalties. But they do technically pass it on. So every year we send concert programs to ASCAP and BMI of all the concerts that are played in the HVAC. We don't report like what gets played in the Marriott Center and what gets played in Lavelle Edwards Stadium. That they just use formulas for radio and digital radio to try and like best estimate how much to pay people. But it's not a science. But it, you know, I think 85% of their profits go towards paying songwriters and publishers. So they, I think they do, they have about 12 to 15% overhead. So they keep, that's what they claim, is they keep their overhead low, and then they are in the business of, and there are people who, I mean, the Jeopardy themed guy gets a big check every year from ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC for stuff that's put on TV.
Oh, man.
So there are a lot of people who have made a lot of money that way, but, you know, anyway. Okay, so we got it. What's the time on this?
We have an hour and a half, so
okay.
Till 11:30.
Good.
That's 45 minutes.
So the next one. Anybody, any guesses? D, the first.
Ring?
Huh?
Ring?
Yep. Are you guys, did you guys watch the tutorial?
Yep, there's
yeah.
A two.
Yeah. So good. Distribution is a big one. This is why, like, ripping CDs is technically illegal. Because you now have created a copy, and then you're distributing, if you make copies for friends and all that. Which nobody does that anymore. So I guess I should say, like, emailing an MP3 to lots of people. And now listen, I am a copyright guy, and I have emailed MP3s to my family or something, like, just to show them something. Or I even would make these mixes of stuff. Anyway, so I have broken copyright law. We all have. But it's in post.
Yeah.
Cut that out in post. I have never broken a copyright law in my entire life. Anyway, so it's just a balance. I'm not here to fearmonger at all, but when you represent BYU, you do represent a different institution. And I think FHS recently knows what that means. So that is what you need to understand. From, and I'll give you some case law that will scare you, which should scare you when you go work for a company, that you now represent somebody else and a huge potential target. You know, if you go work for Coca-Cola or whomever, you need to understand what you're doing and that you can't just willy-nilly rip things. And I mean, if you ask a Coca-Cola ad if you can rip a YouTube video and use it in an advertisement, I assume most of you would say you'd be worried about providing that content to, you know, that you would get stocked footage, or you do whatever that seems. So I'm here to teach you what that looks like. In your own personal private lives, your risk is probably very low, but you know, you should really be concerned about the golden rule, about not ripping off profits from artists, because you're artists yourselves, you know, so you don't want to undercut their market, you know, give them due where you should. And I think as artists, you should recognize that reciprocity. That you want your art respected, and so you should respect other people's. Yeah.
Really quick, my dad, like, bootlegs concerts.
Uh-huh.
Kind of, you know, just this funny thing that he does. And he doesn't sell them or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
And he only does them at concerts that allow him to, right? Like, venues that don't, like, check you for phones or, like,
uh-huh.
no camera. They, like, don't see any of that stuff.
Yeah.
And sometimes he'll, like, send them to other fans that he meets at shows, and just
uh-huh.
say, like, here's a recording of this show
yeah.
that we were all at.
Yeah.
Is that illegal?
Uh-huh.
Okay. I'm going to tell him that, because he doesn't think it is.
Section 1101
is
where it's technically illegal to record somebody's performance without permission. Now, one of my favorite bands is County Crows. Great band. They love their fans bootlegging their concerts.
Okay.
Because there are fans who have created an index of all of their concerts, like
yeah.
hundreds of concerts, and it's an incredible resource, right?
Yeah.
But that's just, it doesn't mean that they're not breaking law, it just means they haven't been sued.
Yeah, prosecuted.
Which, you know, if you're an individual doing that, your risk is also, it's just low.
Yeah,
but,
okay, cool.
Yeah.
Good to know.
Okay, so the next ones you may not know, but, I said the other one, but it's display. So this is for static display. That's a right, so for artwork and such. And then the digital audio transmission of sound recordings is a really weird right that Congress granted in 1995, and I don't have time to go into, but basically Spotify has to pay that right, and so does Pandora. If it's a digital audio transmission of a sound recording, which actually I'll get to later when I explain the difference between musical composition and sound recordings. So Rap Triple D, if you can remember that, you can generally know when you're infringing copyright. So, and in fact, so are they familiar with the FHSS audio?
Some of them are.
Okay.
Probably not everybody.
And I'm on camera, so I don't know if
It's
okay.
I'm okay with it.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So in that instance where a student used the library music, he or she, I don't remember who it was, they that was a contract law violation rather than a copyright violation, mm-hmm. because he did or she, I honestly don't know who it is, I'll just say he downloaded it legally and bought a license, but just bought the wrong license. And so it didn't apply for the use for a university. It was a personal use license. It was like, you know, $5 or something, which should be some flag. That is really cheap. You know, like, the market is not stupid, right? They know what they're doing. So none of these rights were technically implicated in that use. It was more of a contractual violation, which, so I just wanted to clarify that difference. If that makes any sense. Okay. So, how long does copyright last? Does anybody know? Oh.
7 years. I'm with the author of Lesson Plus 7 years.
Nice.
You
guys are so smart. Which is so long, but we started with a 7 year term when we first started copyrighting. Now it's going to Life of the Author Plus 70, which is the industry or the international standard. That's also why. We actually like to call this the Mickey Mouse Copyright Extension Act because it used to be Life Plus 50 years until 1998. This is not the technical name of the act, but in copyright circles, Mickey Mouse was up for, the Steamboat Willie Mickey Mouse was up for expiration in like 2008, I think. I don't know if you know.
Oh, I can't remember off the top of my head.
Shalisa's dad was a lawyer for Disney, so that's why I'm asking her. But,
yeah,
So 2008, I think, is when it was up, and then they lobbied hard, and you know they had some reason because you know Canada's Life Plus 50, but most countries in Europe are Life Plus 70. Mexico is Life Plus 100, believe it or not. I don't know what. Anyway, so this they extended it in 1998, and because of the impending doom of Steamboat Willie, we like to call this. So the question is when it's up for expiration in 2028, what will Disney do then? We don't know. Or other lobbyists. Hopefully they don't increase it. Yeah.
So after that, it just enters the public domain then?
Yeah.
Anybody can use it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's a question I had, because like I was, like personally I was planning to do a game, and there are like a bunch of characters that are public domain, like Popeye, and like even, like pretty much like all the comic books era from the gold era from the like Captain America and all the stuff, they are actually public domain, but then it's kind of like it needs to be the old one, not the new one,
uh-huh.
but then the name is the same, and I was trying to go online and see how that works, and like
yeah
Marvel has better lawyers than you, so it's better to be careful.
Yeah.
And so like how does that really
So work? It's a good question of derivative works of public domain works. So Frankenstein is a good example of this too. That's a novel from the 1800s, so it's in the public domain. But Universal created the iconic Frankenstein character with, you know, is it yeah, and there were a ton of different iterations, but that's the one that stuck. And so they have claimed a copyright in the derivative of the public domain character, and that if you use that image, then you could be infringing their intellectual property. So anything that's new, that's added to the original character, would be potentially protected. But anything that's from the original character, including the name, should be public domain. But then there's also trademark stuff that could be attached to a name. I didn't know Captain America was pre-1923.
Yeah, I think it was. I was seeing through a list, but
yeah.
it was pretty much like everybody from the GOAT era comics.
Well, Disney is masterful at this, right? So they take old stories and they just repackage them in ways that are massive successes. So Alice in Wonderland is public domain. You know, Frozen from the Ice Queen, public domain, Sleeping Beauty, all these stories are public domain, which is why it's just the irony, right? Because they're just, some say they're just ripping off other people's ideas, but you know, they know how to add value to that. I mean, they're really brilliant creators in their storylines and how it connects to humanity and all that. And so they, so everything that's new, but the original Ice Queen story, you can do whatever you want with that, but you have to be careful just to make sure not to copy any of the new stuff that's been added. So, which leads us into public domain. So 1923 is your magic date. If you remember this date, anything prior to 1923 is fair game in the US. That date will start changing in 2019. It'll start going up 1 year at a time. So it'll be 1924 and then 1925, if that makes sense.
So in 2019, it will be 1924.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so it's 5 years. I mean, like 95 years.
Yeah. Yeah, good math. So, yeah, so basically, because the Life Plus 70 only applies to post 1978 works, anything between 1923 and 1977, those have a 95-year duration. And so that's why this date exists. Which makes things really complicated, because people want to use stuff in that era, and there were different laws. You know, a lot of the projects I send to Shalice are like, you know, this is a 1960 publication. Can you check and see if the registration was renewed, and if there was a copyright notice? And there's a lot of things back in the day you had to do. You had to put a copyright notice. In fact, Night of the Living Dead, they forgot to put a copyright notice on their movie when they released it, which is why that movie entered the public domain once it was published. I don't know if you knew that. Are you familiar with that movie? No? Some? Night of the Living Dead is like a cult classic movie.
Zombie. You're talking about the original Black and White?
Huh?
You're talking about the original Black and White?
Yeah. And they, the guy who was in charge of the title credits, they changed the title last minute and forgot to put the copyright notice on the new title. And so that's how it was back in those days. You had to put a copyright notice or else you didn't get protection. So when we're analyzing these older works, that's what we look for. So some examples of public domain, you know, Book of Mormon. The 1985 version is protected, but only things that are newly added. So that's a question I get a lot. I can unequivocally and should unequivocally say that you can use the scriptures however you like. I can't tell you how many people ask the church for permission to use the scriptures. They don't own a copyright in the Book of Mormon. Now, as a Mormon, you may have, you know, some questions about whether or not they would like endorse your use, or that's a different kind of thing. But because it was published in 1830. It's in the public domain, so which is why the Book of Mormon musical can happen, and which is why you can anybody can do whatever they want with it. Yeah.
What about the more recent translations? Which would be like derivative works, right?
Yeah. Good applications, exactly right. So the translations would be protected.
Okay.
And really, the only thing my boss and I disagree on this, but well, the chapter headings that McConkie wrote in 85, those would be new literary works that would be protected, and I don't agree that the footnotes would be, but my boss does. He's a lawyer, so you can probably go with him if you want. But I don't think it warrants enough originality to be protected. Plus, I don't know how. Anyway, so if you want to copy it or something, you just go straight to the old version, or just copy the non-chapter headings and footnotes. But and the works of the government are in the public domain. So if it's created by the federal government, then or employees of the federal government. So this is the big slide to probably sort of end on, but because this is the question about like, what images can I use in videos and all that for like non-commercial use. This is what we generally recommend. A, try and find public domain materials, which you now know what that is. Two, how many of you have heard of Creative Commons licenses? Just the people who watched the tutorial, and maybe you? So those are licenses that people, kind of like this free stuff, like here, you can use it. If it has a CC on it, it's just click on the license and see what it says, but it means you can generally use those images for the purposes that it allows, which is usually pretty open. So there are millions of images out there that are under CC license that are potentially usable.
Have you heard of Unsplash?
Yeah.
Do they use Creative Commons,
uh-huh,
or do they just... throw it up.
Oh, there. Actually, I think Unsplash might be the site that, that gives you a license just on their terms of use. Pixabay uses a CC license. Pexels uses a CC license.
Okay.
Unsplash is one of our favorite.
Yeah, me too.
Because they're really beautiful photos that professional photographers have basically donated. And but I think that might be just terms of use.
Okay.
So.
Another they just like they please credit if you can.
Yeah.
Like that kind of
thing. They ask for a complimentary credit, yeah. And they even give you like an embed link.
Yeah,
yeah, so the databases is also an option. I wanted to show you, since you guys know, this will be really useful for you. So as an example, why am I not on the non-guest network?
Have at your own
on there. Yeah, I saw that. Can I use that?
Are you connected to
connected now? Yeah, I'm connected now.
Okay.
So on our website, we have a bunch of different resources, but
that's not showing. You need to.
Oh. Whoops. I think I need to drag this or something.
There you go.
There you go. Okay.
So our website has a bunch of resources. Well, now I can see. Here we go. Where is my mouse? Okay. And one of them is images and music. So we try to highlight some of the best free licensed sites. And as you can see, Pixabay, and Unsplash are listed as. I thought I just muted it. Okay. So if you go here, so for example, I just posted something like on our website, and I needed an image of like a yoga person. So I think I went to Pexels or something, and I found this image, you know, to just post for this blog, which was about whether or not yoga poses can be copyrighted. So, you know, it's a nice looking image, it's professional, and there's no copyright issues. So generally, if you stick to these kinds of images and image sites, you stay away from problems. Just make sure you read the license. But if you see, how many of you know Pexels? Have you seen this? And they're really great websites with lots and lots of good pictures. So if you were to type in, I don't know, somebody give me a search.
Football?
Then you have
wrong sport.
The right sport.
Yeah, football and America.
So if you click on this, what you can see over here is a CCO license. So it tells you what you can do. And if you want to learn more about the license, then you can just click on that. And one of the other tricks I'll teach you is Google search, which I know that's where everybody goes first anyway. So what you can do is let's type in football, and we'll type images, or click images, and I'll just go to tools, and I can filter based on usage rights. And all of these are the Creative Commons, different types of Creative Commons licenses. So labored for reuse, I think, is the broadest license. And this is just a guide. You can't trust Google with everything, which is surprising, right? But if you can see, that is an image from Pexels. So they've managed to brilliantly do that somehow. And that's from Pixabay, which is another Creative Commons license. So if you're unsure, you know, you just click on the license, or you click on the image, and then you click visit the page. And then if you did this, then you would see, oh, it really is a CC license. That's how you kind of check. So you guys use images a lot?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The designers use them all the time.
Yep. What do you use for your sources?
Unsplash or like photography that, you know, somebody like BYU Photo has taken of professors.
iStock photos sometimes.
iStock, yeah, we have accounts that have credits on iStock and
good.
Some other things.
So you guys already got that down then.
Yeah.
I think.
But the free ones are even
better.
Yeah, the free
ones. What was I just going to say?
What about images that we just see on the web and copy? I want to stick it on a website.
Well, now you're trained. You grab triple D, you know?
I mean, I think the answer's obvious, but...
Yeah.
So
the safest answer is that, no, you shouldn't do that. But we haven't gotten to fair use yet, but, you know, there's always a potential fair use argument. Yeah.
I have a question. So my program on campus, I won't name it because if I say something wrong, I don't want you to get them in trouble. But
you make it sound like I'm a mean cop.
Like, we have portfolios, obviously, to get jobs, right?
Yeah.
Which technically all of the work that we do is student work, right? Mm-hmm. Like, some of it we do for clients, but, like, big, you know, corporations and whatnot. But most of it is just, like, things that we came up with an idea and we were like, oh, let's go do this.
Mm-hmm.
And we can make, like, a video with, like, a song embedded into it or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not, like, for commercial use. It's
mm-hmm.
just for our portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a website portfolio, so it's online.
Mm-hmm.
Is that like breaking copyright? Because we're students technically, and we're not using it for any commercial use.
Yeah, we need to get to fair use. So hold your question.
Okay.
The answer is yes.
Yes,
it is likely copyright infringement there, but there might be an exemption.
Okay. Okay.
That's okay. So one of the most important things to understand is music licensing. So this is a good segue. This is what I was going to show you. So if you're interested, one of the things we're doing and trying to do is keep up to date on all of the image sites, because you know they change a lot. So if you are interested, like with your office accounts, we have an Instagram account that we highlight these free image sites. We highlight every Friday, we call it Free Photo Friday, and basically highlight, or we post our own images, like when we raised our turtles in the Turtle Dash. But these are all images from free stock photo sites. So it's potentially a good follow if you want to kind of see new sites that crop up. We kind of keep our finger on the pulse of that. So, like, I've seen this on so many articles, this image online, because everybody's using it, you know, which they can. So that's just an FYI. Okay, so music licensing. The biggest thing to understand about music licensing is that there are two sides to the same coin. This gets very confusing for a lot of people, but basically, a song that you hear on the radio has the music composition, the words and lyrics, or words and music, and then on the other side you have the sound recording. And they are different, and under the law, they are different. So it's important to understand the difference. So when University Communications wanted me to get One Republic's Hall of Fame song for like a spot that they wanted to put on ESPN, I had to get permission from the songwriters and from the record label who owned the recording. So it required two different permissions, which cost the exact same, so it doubles your cost. So this is an important thing to understand in the video world, in the media world. So when you're talking about, eventually when you get into an advertising, you know, campaign, and you want to use a U2 song.
How did you know that that's what my major is?
I
deductive reasoning.
but U2,
caused trouble.
And I didn't know 100% until now.
I mean, you pointed at me and you said, when you do an advertising thing,
I was fishing.
Shoot.
But, you know, so Nabisco or whomever, they have to get U2's record label clearance and U2's publishing clearance.
So your blanket license doesn't cover that?
No. Because it's not just a public performance, it's a reproduction and distribution.
Oh.
But, yeah.
Okay. So if you have... I hire a band to cover it, I would just need the one, the publishing part, not
yep.
the other part.
Yeah. Cool. Smart group. That's exactly right. So, Vocal Point, all their YouTube videos, right, they are singing it themselves. They don't need permission from the artist who originally sang it. They just need permission from the publisher, which may be the artist, as songwriters, depends on the artist. Not everybody writes their own songs these days, which is a shame. But That's how music licensing works. So a famous example, which we don't have time to play, but is Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You. How many of you think Whitney Houston wrote that?
Yeah. Yeah. More.
How about David Foster, Dolly Parton?
Dolly Parton.
You guys already know this. Yeah. Michael Jackson.
Dolly Parton.
So Dolly Parton wrote the original song, but not as many people had heard it by the time Whitney Houston just launched it into the stratosphere of fame. So every time that played, Whitney Houston just got the royalties for the sound recording, not the song. And Dolly Parton made money on every single sale of the Whitney Houston record.
So that's like Johnny Cash's Hurt, Nine Inch Nails.
Yep. Yeah. Hallelujah, Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah.
Yeah. Wow.
So the money is in writing.
Gotcha.
Cool.
Because you get royalties. So the Beatles famously don't own their publishing rights. So Paul McCartney still. So sad, but he signed away his publishing rights, and so he's fine. But if you write all this stuff and it's being used in ways that you have no control over now, that's unfortunate. But he tried to buy his rights back, but guess who outbid him?
Apple.
Michael Jackson,
really?
Who was his friend, was, and Paul McCartney taught him about the music publishing. Said that's where the real money is because he was on the other end of it, and then so now Michael Jackson's estate is the one who owns most of the Beatles songs.
So was it like 3 years ago that all of a sudden all the Beatles music was on Spotify and
mm-hmm.
and everywhere? What happened there?
I don't know if it just took a while for them to reach an agreement, or if the mergers and stuff took a long time before they could really make a decision. But
that's Michael Jackson's estate that made that decision.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of sad.
That's crazy.
So yeah, that's the difference in music licensing. So Mack Wilberg is a famous example of repurposing public domain very smartly. So he takes Come Thou Fount and then he revamps it, and now all of the new stuff in his arrangements are copyrighted, but the original lyrics and words and music or melody is not. So you could still write an arrangement yourself, but you can't copy anything that's new to him. Yeah.
Do you have, back on your website, you've got those resources for photos. Do you also have resources for free music that we could be using?
Yeah. Yeah. It's that's a good, that's
it
a
was?
Okay. Link with Eminem Music.
Did you see it? Yeah.
Okay.
There is, I don't know.
It's on the left there.
It's the university has Omnimusic. Have you guys heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
Omnimusic is, Omnimusic is a site that we've already paid for. It's, it's crappy music, but it's supposed to be underscore music that you don't really care about, right?
Yeah.
And a lot of videos can use it and be fine. You can find good music. It's just not going to be recognizable. But there's lots of tracks there. And there's also, I think, the Music Bed, Song Freedom has Summer and Five and Imagine Dragons, and it's like $100 for a license. It's pretty good.
For unlimited, whatever you want to use.
For university purposes, when I looked it up, the license was, I think, 150 or something. So if you really want something that's recognizable, just look at some of these other sites that offer it. You're going to get what you pay for. So free music is going to be free and not the best. But if you do want something recognizable, I recommend Song Freedom. If not, I probably just recommend not using. It's so complex to get licensing. That clearance that I did for University Comms, the reason we did it is because it was an ESPN spot, so it was a huge liability. But it took me 6 months to clear that song. And it was thousands of dollars in a license. So it's just not easy to get those licenses. So, and honestly, there's a lot of good pro bono music around here that you could also encourage people to just, write music and give you a license forever. To use their music in a in a song. We've actually thought of hosting an invitation for all BYU music people and local bands to upload songs that gives BYU a permanent license, and then we can have a catalog of songs that people like you guys across campus could use. But we haven't done that just yet, so you could reach out to them directly. But this is one of those examples of copyright. It does promote creation. Even though it feels like a like it's damning your progress of like, oh, I can't use Imagine Dragons, I should be able to use that. If it forces you to create something on your own or like commission something, you have now just created something. So that's kind of the concept behind it. But yeah, Omnimusic you should use if you, and I think iStock and some of these other, Getty, they have music libraries as well. So
also not the best.
Yeah. And YouTube has free MP3s, and they're just, you know, but a lot of videos, you know, how much of your videos like require a very specific song? I would say, I mean, the one that we got into trouble with here, like those did, Omnimusic could have easily been the free track, but I just think the student didn't know we had Omnimusic, so that can easily replace. It was just underscore for the faculty spotlight videos, so yeah.
Is there a certain amount of time? Like,
no.
There's nothing. You can't play 2 seconds of a song.
There's no time decided in the law. It doesn't. Mm-hmm. There's nothing that says 10 seconds or less or 10% or less. In the fair use, which that's where they talk about it. But let me just get there finally. How do I? Okay, so fair use, we talked about it. It's an exemption for purposes of these things, criticism, comment, etc. The good acronym we come up with is PAIN. So we call it a PAIN analysis, and it's purpose, amount, which goes to your question, the impact on the market, and then the nature of the work. So this is how judges do analysis of, so this judge, in fact, I don't know if you recognize from the Gila YouTube case, do you recognize?
Well, they said that the amount had really nothing to do with it because it was obvious that they weren't trying to make a market replacement.
Exactly.
For the video.
So you just read a fair use analysis. That's really cool. That's where the law meets the road. I mean, those judges analyzed these exact four factors.
Yeah.
So this isn't just some theory. This is actually what judges have to use when they're analyzing fair use. And they probably said that the purpose was, I don't know if they said commercial or non-commercial. Do you remember? Even if it was commercial.
It has to be commercial because they wanted to monetize it. So.
Yeah. So, but even though it was commercial, it was considered
a fair
use. And the amount, they said it didn't matter because, well, although they may have said that, you know, did they use the whole?
They might have used, I mean, they definitely used a significant, I mean, it just went like play by play. Like
commentary on different clips.
Here's the next 10 seconds, let's
talk
about
it.
Here's the next 10 seconds, let's talk about it. I actually watched it last night because they re-uploaded it.
Which clearly is not going to replace the market for somebody to watch the original. So that's where the impact is the biggest one on the fair use. It's like, what's the impact on the market? But yeah.
So there's a lot of YouTube channels out there.
Uh-huh.
Watch Mojo, What Culture,
uh-huh.
Writer, Honest Trailers, that are clearly using copyrighted content. I would imagine that it would be very difficult for them to get permission from each person.
Uh-huh.
I'm assuming that the reason why they are able to profit, because these are YouTubers.
Yeah, it's their careers.
Full time.
Yeah.
And so all of the money that they're getting in is from the advertising there. My thoughts are it's probably somewhere in this fair use.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it is the amount, the nature, yeah, they're doing commentary or in some cases criticism.
Yeah, this is likely, but it doesn't mean somebody can't sue you. It just means you have a defense, which is what the Gila lawsuit proves. But yeah, most of the time when you see that, sometimes it's just flat out infringing and they're just not getting caught, you know, or not being pursued, and sometimes they are relying on this.
Yeah.
So all you have to do is check one of these boxes.
No. No, it's a balance.
Okay.
Yeah, so they're not dispositive, so you know, a commercial use could still be fair, like we've shown, and using 100% of the work could still be fair. It just depends on the balance of all the other factors.
Okay.
So if your use of the 100% of the work wasn't really necessary for your purpose, it was more than you needed. So the famous case is the Harry Potter lexicon case, where the case died because the judge ruled that the author used too much verbatim passages from Harry Potter in the lexicon.
Gotcha.
So the amount was the killer in that case, because the purpose was pretty transformative. Like, even though it was commercial, it was using it in a different way that was commenting or, you know, repurposing. And the impact on the market, they said, was bad for her because she could have licensed these kinds of things. So, so it's just a balance of those factors. And some of the, you know, so 10% of the work is a myth, educational is a myth, non-commercial. All those things can help, but they just, they're not dispositive for a fair use. So just, and you know, when we're talking about risk assessment, it's also quite low if your audience is limited and all that. So it's just, it's a very nuanced, which makes it really difficult, and it's probably why you want to yawn about it. But it's, I like that it's flexible because it actually gives us more room to claim fair use. If they drew hard lines, then we'd have to be more limited. So some people will complain that it's too ambiguous, but so let me give you some examples. You guys would be interested in this as we close up. So this, an intern at Monster Energy Drink, no, intern turned marketing director. So he moved up in the chain. He used a 3-minute DJ mashup of Beastie Boys. He got permission from the DJ, but he didn't get permission from Beastie Boys. So this is the, where he didn't understand the two sides of the coin. The DJ, who got permission from Beastie Boys to create the mashup, he just owns the recording side. He doesn't own the lyrics and the music. And so he only got one side, permission for one side, and he just didn't know to get the other side, and Monster Energy Drink should have had somebody checking. But it was just in a YouTube video, and it cost $2 million in damages. So,
I mean, it's probably because it's a big company.
Yeah, this is why I say you have to. You, when you go out and work for a big company, it's a whole different ball game.
Yeah.
Right.
Totally.
Another famous case: Fox posted this image, this juxtaposition, and they settled, likely for a lot of money, with the photographer. It was just a social media post on Facebook. This is a famous case, but I'm going to kind of skip it. This just because it's undecided, but we'll go to another one. Another photojournalism case. This was just settled. Breitbart used this photo in a news article, but without permission. This is one of the first famous social media cases. He was there for the Haiti earthquake, and he started posting them to his Twitter account, and all these news companies took the images and started, because in real time, these images are really valuable, right? Because
yeah.
They're trying to report on the news, and they tried to rely on fair use, and they lost.
Wow.
So,
nice. Props to him.
Yeah, actually, that was a good one for photographers.
Yeah.
But this is the famous, Donald Trump Jr. took this image of Skittles off of Flickr, and it did not have a Creative Commons license, and he used it, and this lawsuit is still going on as far as I know. But
oh,
the irony is that the... Do you guys remember this photo?
No,
I didn't see it.
Where he compared Skittles to refugees. Anyway, the guy who took the photo is a refugee.
Oh my god.
Like from
gosh.
The UK. And so just like the alignment of all the wrong things was.
Go get him.
I mean, he was Trump Jr., right? UK hates Trump. And the guy was a photographer who uploaded this image to Flickr, and he was an immigrant himself. So.
Oh my gosh.
Anyway, there were a couple hands.
So a question I had about like some, for example, so for example, if I get a right to play a song in a venue, then I make a DVD of me playing the song.
Uh-huh.
Can I sell and distribute that DVD because I paid the license?
You tell me. Rap Triple D. You have a license for the P, public performance. You now want to create a DVD and distribute it.
So I guess not. So I would have to go and pay
distribution rights and reproduction rights.
So you need an individual license for each one of those things.
Or permission, yeah. They're exclusive rights.
Okay.
It means they're exclusive to them. Unless you have a fair use exemption, which some, you know, documentaries have that exemption for criticism or comment. Unless you have some sort of exemption in the law, academically we have certain exemptions and questions, then you can answer all those questions. Look, we applied Rap Triple D. That was really exciting.
Go ahead. Can I just interrupt real quick?
Yeah.
We've got 5 minutes left. Are you able to stay a little later, or are you?
We have a staff meeting.
Okay.
So I probably need to.
So can you wrap it up? Are there any other specific questions regarding our work that we need to get answered real quick?
Yeah.
So, how do you go about getting getting permission to use something? Is there like a formal document? Do we need to bring in a lawyer? All of that, or like, do we just need to email them, spell out what it is we're gonna do, and getting like an email back that says, yeah, you can do this.
Yeah, you can get those kinds of informal permissions. If there's no fees being exchanged, I think those emails would suffice. Yeah, you just need to contact the copyright owner. If you need help, you can just contact us. So I'll leave some cards. That's what we do is help get clearances for various departments across campus to use music to reduce our liability. So yeah, so hopefully this is a good question and probably something I should come back to. It's just the practical aspects of how you like go about your job. So hopefully you've seen some resources that you can use. And then, you know, feel encouraged to either create yourself or even, you know, utilize the creativity of those around you. But if you are wanting something in particular, then yes, just contact them. Just use your Google stalking skills, and that's what we do, just on a higher level. But but yeah, you just need to get in touch with them and make sure that they have the rights to give you, that they own the work, and that they can give you the rights.
So. I'm really curious about this slide that you have up because this pertains exactly to.
Yeah, so this is an exact example of years ago. A student designer took this image off of. I can never remember. I don't use it. Imgur?
Illegally.
It was just off of a social media site.
Okay.
And then she or he repurposed it into this BYU poster, and the photographer found it and contacted BYU.
How in the world did they find it?
So the same way they found this audio sucker stuff, they have much better digital tools of monitoring.
Okay.
And they uploaded this to the CFAC website.
Oh, okay.
So had this not even been uploaded, we probably would have been contacted.
Yeah.
But this is an example of like, it doesn't mean that you just got free. It's just somebody hasn't found it, and so now this could have easily been avoided by just finding stock images or something,
yeah, totally.
Right? But yeah, that's an example of repurposing
so
something.
BYU had to settle for money for this.
Yeah. Yeah, most of we haven't been sued yet. If we do get sued, I'll probably get fired, so that's like my only job.
But that doesn't mean that BYU's not paying fines or
yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, no, like
for mistakes like this or the one in our video.
Stowaway magazine, if you've heard of that, had another problem with students just using images that they uploaded. Online increases a lot of risk. I mean even print publications, all those things are either stock or should be free images, but yeah.
And this is also because it was like a university, like, program, right? Like this, yeah, obviously this kid didn't just like, hey, look at this cool thing that I made. It was like, I'm doing this for a client, basically.
Yeah, I don't know if he would have contacted the individual himself, but...
Okay. Since it was a large university that has...
Well, just think about you as a copyright owner. If you want money or you want something, you're
yeah.
going to go after the bigger target.
Cool.
Always. But it doesn't mean... So there is a ridiculous case of a student who used an image in an advertising class created an ad, kind of a mock ad, and the photographer found it and is suing that student individually because the university got themselves recused from the lawsuit. So we actually reached out to her and we got her a lawyer to pro bono.
Which
represent
went to BYU?
No, it was a different university.
Oh, okay.
But we just heard about it, and we just are just absolutely mind-blowingly offended by the fact that this photographer is suing this student for a clear academic fair use that should never be. This girl should not be dealing with this. But that's not to scare you. It's just because that absolutely should be allowed.
Absolutely terrifies me.
Well, if you come to our office and ask me if you could do what she did, I would say wholeheartedly yes.
Okay.
Like, that's what I would say, because it is a fair use. Because
I got a website chock full of images that I do not take video.
All right. Well,
cool.
let's give Ty a hand. I thought that was great.